Welcome! I am Alberto Gullino from Electronics and Telecommunication Department of Politecnico di Torino. This is my presentation entitled Modulation Response of Pixels, a Physics-Based Simulation Approach. This work has been carried out in collaboration with Italian CNR, Trumpf Photonics Components, and Ulm University. Aim of this presentation is to investigate the dynamic behavior of a pixel. This kind of analysis is crucial for pixels, since they are extensively exploited in datacom applications. Therefore, we want to explore this device's amplitude modulation at high frequencies. In this view, the most significant parameter results to be the modulation bandwidth, which also defines the speed of the laser. This figure of merit can be extracted by means of the rate equations model, which, however, is a phenomenological model that can be exploited to extract parameters from already available data, therefore resulting to be not very predictive, even though very fast. On the other hand, our in-house 3D solver Venus provides an entirely physics-based approach, involving optical, thermal, and electrical problems that are solved self-consistently to return very accurate results. However, the high degree of accuracy is achieved at cost of heavy computational burden that entails substantial time-consuming simulations. What we want to present here is the possibility of grasping the details of the dynamic behavior of a pixel, avoiding the use of the computational intensive Venus by means of a simplified version of it, Diana. This is simply based on a 1D deep diffusion solver that results to be 100 times faster than Venus, yet returning reliable results, such that it can be used for extended parametric campaign or, as done in this work, a significantly faster dynamic analysis. Before going on, I want to give you a little bit of introduction about the structure of an oxide-confined aluminum gallium arsenide pixel. Basically, a bias is applied to the contacts. From them, carriers are injected and reach the active region passing through semiconductive DBRs and an oxide aperture. Here, carriers recombine, providing photon generation, allowing for vertical emission of coherent light. This is a transverse section of the refractive index profile of the pixel investigated in Venus. It is clear that all the main features are included in the solver. Notice that this is a compact version of the actual device. In fact, only a few of the DBR pairs in the proximity of the active region are reported in the figure to better highlight all the relevant details of the structure. Of course, the substrate and the bottom contact are also simulated, even though they are not shown here. Now, Diana is briefly presented. First, the details about the simulated structure must be uploaded, such as the doping profile, the molar fraction, the length of the layers, and the models among the available ones are selected. Full or incomplete ionization of dopants, Fermi-Boltzmann statistic for carrier distribution, quantum correction to describe accurately the quantum wells and connect their population to the bulk one, and the optical model obtained from lookup tables for the gain and the spontaneous emission, and from the optical solver VELM for the optical losses and the output wavelength. All this allows for an actual physics-based approach of the analysis of the device. Then, a one-dimensional non-uniform geometrical mesh is generated. The initial guess for the drift diffusion solver is provided by the solution at the thermodynamic equilibrium. Since the drift diffusion system is a non-linear system, an iterative scheme is required to reach the final solution. This iterative scheme is the Newton's method that relies on the use of the Jacobian matrix. This will be crucial for the small signal analysis in the next slides. In fact, the small signal analysis block can be simply added after each steady state analysis step. This is due to the fact that AC analysis performed in this work only involves small signal analysis. As a consequence, quantities can be linearized around the DC bias point by means of Taylor expansions. Therefore, starting from DC Jacobian metrics obtained at each steady state iteration and adding to it an AC Jacobian matrix accounting for the dynamics of the current equations, dopants, of carrier densities, of quantum correction, and of optical power, it is possible to retrieve the needed modulation response of the device. Before solving the full VCSEL structure in Diana, we want to validate our small signal model. This is done by comparing the small signal electrical features, such as the differential conductance and the differential capacitance, of a simple PIM structure obtained from Centaurus device by Synopsys to the one coming from Diana. As clear from the figure, the quantities are superimposed up to a frequency of 10 to the 4 GHz. Now we are ready to move to the core of our simulations. A few remarks are needed. First of all, notice that Diana simulates a vertical cut generated at rho equals zero of the structure simulated in Venus, exploiting the axisymmetric feature of the device. Furthermore, the top contact is assumed to be aligned to the oxide aperture. A crucial step in our simulations is the connection between Diana and experimental results, already at steady state conditions. In this view, an optimal fitting has been achieved by multiplying the oxide aperture area of the actual device, 4.7 microns of diameter, by a size factor of 1.7. This leads to a larger effective area, which is able to account for some of the 3D features which are naturally included in Venus, such as the lateral diffusion of carriers, the top annular contact, and the three-dimensional profile of the fields inside the active region of the VCSEL. Eventually, take in mind that Diana does not include any thermal effect yet. As a consequence, small signal analysis has been performed only in the linear part of the static LI curves, therefore, before the VCSEL thermal roll-off begins. Let's now present the results. These are the experimental static IV and LI curves. If the size factor is not introduced inside the Diana simulation, the static curves show some difference with respect to the experimental one. The optical threshold is underestimated at 0.2 milliamps. The slope of the IV curve is smaller. On the other hand, the introduction of the size factor improves the static results, bringing the optical threshold to 0.4 milliamps and the slope of the IV curve closer to the experimental one. Before presenting the results concerning the VCSEL bandwidth, it is worth understanding how it is determined. In particular, as any diode laser, a VCSEL is characterized by an intrinsic laser response and an extrinsic parasitic response. In our physics-based approach, the equivalent intrinsic laser impedance is computed together with the resistance modeling the losses due to the contacts and the DBR, and the capacitance due to the diode junction, the oxide capacitance, and the mesa capacitance. What is missing in Diana is an external parasitic RC network introduced by the pad capacitance between signal and ground from probe tips to the metal contacts, and by the pad resistance accounting for the pad and wire losses. This external network behaves as a single pole low pass filter, and it is a limiting factor for a VCSEL bandwidth. Let's now present the normalized amplitude modulation response obtained in measurements performed at Yale University of the investigated oxide-confined aluminum gallium arsenide pixel. As already mentioned, modulation curves are displayed only for current values below thermal roll-off, where optical emission of the pixel is still monomodal. The peaks arising in the curves are due to the fact that photons and carrier modulation follows current modulation for frequencies up to relaxation, which in turn depends on bias current itself. They are called relaxation oscillation peaks, and after them the response decreases due to the presence of three poles, a parasitic one and two paraoptical ones. Therefore, as the current increases, the bandwidth increases as well, and the peak's height flattens. Measurements suggest a bandwidth of approximately 6 GHz at 1 milliamp and of 8 GHz at 2 milliamps. As expected, if the external parasitic network is not included, the bandwidth increases with the current. However, the peaks do not flatten, therefore overestimating both the oscillation relaxation peak height and the bandwidth. Furthermore, the absence of the parasitic pole results in a smaller slope with respect to measurements. On the other hand, as the parasitic RC network is taken into account by introducing a pole at 2 GHz, Diana returns curves much closer to the experimental ones. In fact, the slope of the curves is similar to the expected three-pole one, and the peaks are reduced as the current increases. Still, the position of such peaks is different for equal current values, and also the height is overestimated. The latter problem is partially solved by introducing in our physics-based simulator the gain compression factor that reduces the gain of the laser and therefore the height of the relaxation oscillation peak, which now is very similar to the experimental one. In conclusion, the simplified version of our entirely 3D physics-based solver Venus returns accurate static LI and IV curves once the size factor is introduced in the simulation. This is able to partially compensate the lack of 3D details in the 1D solver. Dynamic results are very promising since they show the same features coming from the experiments. However, some further work is needed to match the modulation responses at equal current values. A good starting point would be the inclusion of a one-dimensional thermal solver self-consistent with the electrical solver in Diana, in order to figure out the role of temperature in dynamic analysis and to extend the comparisons with experiments up to higher currents. Fine, thank you for your attention. My presentation is now over, but I am here to answer all of your questions.